The Blokebusters podcast is proud to be a member of the Pod Bros Network. You can find us, as well as other fantastic podcasts such as Pencil and Ink Review, Another Damn Trivia Show, and The Language of Bromance at podbros.com, as well as on most other fine podcasting services. Now sit back, relax, and prepare to share and enjoy the Blokebusters podcast.
Welcome to another episode of our Film for Thought series here, our little experiment in randomness. Today, we are going to be discussing all-time favorite film scores, possibly touching on soundtracks, other great moments musically in film. And Paul, would you, I'd like to give you the honor of introducing our distinguished guest here.
All right. Well, our guest is someone you've probably never heard of. I mean, his name is Stephen, and he's over at the Storybreakers podcast, which is a lot of fun. And I'm actually going to let him explain exactly what it is he does. So, Stephen, are you there?
I am indeed. Thank you very much for having me on, guys. So, as you've already heard, I am Stephen. I am from the Storybreakers podcast. We come up with a brand new film idea every single week on our show. And the whole idea is, if you like it and you're an aspiring writer, you take it. It's yours.
That's great. I love it. Yeah.
It's always a lot of fun to listen. And I haven't been able to keep up as much as before, but especially at the beginning when passing back ideas about Sherlock noir film or
awesome ideas, definitely.
Or the action genre, just they'll take pretty much any idea and just run with it for an entire film idea. So it really is a lot of fun. Do go check it out.
Definitely worthwhile.
And well, that's it. Story is storytelling is a formula, you know, the kind of way that you just have to kind of stick to. And you know, when things are getting stale, you have to add a little bit of spice to it. You know, it's pretty easy, really going.
Yeah, definitely. This actually was your idea, wasn't it?
Yeah, well, I know myself and Chris, my co-host, we get asked a lot, like, what our favorite films are. And, you know, it's kind of, I think it's very subjective and it's very easy to come up with a top 10, or it's extremely hard and you pick your number one favorite movie. It can kind of change from week to week. But one thing that for me is always a constant is favorite film scores. So quite recently, I went to see Hans Zimmer live, and my mind was blown.
Really? I'm quite jealous to hear that.
yeah. If he ever pops in town near you guys or anyone, it's like, just go see him. He's well worth it. Well worth the admission.
I would imagine. Yeah.
Yeah, and as will become very apparent as this goes on, I am the least qualified to talk about this because film score and music has always taken a back burner for me over the visual, probably because I am partially deaf. So that's not to say that I don't have some favorite musical moments, or there are some times where I'll hear, you know, the title song from a film and it'll just kick everything off for me. But yeah, definitely this will be heralded by Stephen and Brian today.
Oh, I don't know, Paul. I guarantee you're going to be piping in with some amazing opinions in this one.
Yeah, I believe so.
Just don't know yet.
Yeah, well, it's interesting that you say that, because for me, at least for most what I would consider great movies, the score is as integral as the writing, as the performances. It all needs to be there. And one of the best things you can say about a film is that the score has, you know, a lasting effect. It really, you know, you think about it weeks later, months later, and it brings back the experience of seeing that film. So that's what a really powerful score can do.
Yeah, definitely. It's you get it. Like, if someone quotes a movie to you, you know, you remember the part in a movie, but if you hear that music that was playing when that quote happened, it transports you back into the film. You know, it's slightly different, I think, than a lot of the mediums that go into movie making.
Yeah, and there are directors that know, you know, that, you know, continually, you know, work with the same composers or whatever, but that it's a really a really intriguing relationship between the director and the composer. And I mean, so many, you know, like Quentin and I'm blanking on his name right now that just won. You know, John Williams and, you know, Spielberg and just all the people that John Williams has worked with. But I don't know, let's get into Stephen a little bit. Do you have a little short list there of your favorites?
Well, yeah, okay, so since, like, he's right on the tip of my tongue, Hans Zimmer, just seen him last week, stunning. I was actually shocked when I went to see him about how much variety he has in his scores. I looked him up on IMDb afterwards, and he had, like, 179 different movies he's composed, like, from Driving Miss Daisy to The Lion King. Then we all know, like, Gladiator, Pirates of the Caribbean, Inception, Sherlock Holmes, like so many different things. Spider-Pig, even from The Simpsons.
Yes.
He's an amazing guy.
On everything. Yeah, I would echo those sentiments 100%. Yeah, like The Dark Knight, it's just, I love that score. It just builds that film so well. But yeah, Zimmer's definitely up there. For me.
So if you could only pick one of his songs, though, what would you go for? For me, it'd be Time from Inception. You know, the final kind of piece of music when Cobb is going home and he sees his kids. That to me just it breaks me down to a small child every single time.
I don't think I can top that. I think you hit it. It's such a beautiful piece of music. I'm sorry to be a copycat there, but I'm definitely going to have to use that one as well.
You're not a copycat. You just have amazing taste.
That is correct. Yeah. Thank you for noticing.
I don't really know much of his work off the top of my head, but I definitely think that Inception overall, the visuals and the score just go so well together.
Now, it was a bit unfortunate as to how every major film after that had to copy the Wong.
Yes, the Wong.
that got a bit old.
But isn't that kind of like the ultimate compliment, though, as
I suppose.
Like, something so unique that everyone just wants to, like, is inspired by you, you know?
Yeah,
definitely. And I think we can forgive him for doing Batman v Superman.
The best part of that film, actually.
Yeah,
I know.
It was the stuff I didn't have to look at, the stuff I could hear. So obviously, go ahead.
Oh, sorry. No, I think if we're going to be forgiving composers now throughout the show, there's going to be a lot of them. There's like a whole load of kind of whoopee cushions thrown into the mix here, I think, for F movies they've scored.
Yeah, I believe so. Yeah.
I think when it comes to the music side, most people will just keep taking jobs if only because it means they get to keep creating. So
yeah, because they love the process, you know.
You have to pay those bills as well.
Yeah, exactly. Got to keep the lights on. Yeah. But I mean, we're going to get to this guy eventually, so why not now? John Williams.
Amazing.
He's the king of
composing. Yeah, without a doubt.
I was looking up just 10, 15 minutes ago, just like top lists, seeing what the internet had to say. And the best one I found was the first, it was like top 30. And number one was tied with like 8 films, all John Williams. So I was like, that's pretty much nailed it.
How do you pick a favorite movie from him? Like Indiana Jones, Star Wars, Jurassic Park,
yeah. As tough as that would be to say, that is the definition of an iconic just piece of score. Like you said, it takes me back to being 12 years old when I first saw that movie every time I hear it. And the magic of that film, I've talked about this film ad nauseum on this podcast, but it really opened the doors for me to really show what film can be and how it can transport you to another place. And the score was such a huge part of that.
Yeah,
I just love it.
And one thing that I really love doing to my friends is when it comes to John Williams, tell them, okay, hum the Jurassic Park theme, and then when they're about like 8 bars into it, say, all right, hum the Star Wars theme, And then when they're about 8 bars into that, say, okay, now hum the Indiana Jones theme, and then they can't do it.
Because you like melting your friend's brains and you're a cool man. Yeah. Your tongue will lock up.
That's the newest form of torture. That's the new waterboarding.
What a horrible use of beautiful music.
And I don't think it's anything against him. Like, obviously, he has his own formula. Yeah. And he is able to make different music that doesn't sound...
Mm-hmm. Well, he has all of, he uses the same ingredients every time, but he's not making the same dish, you know, every time. It's in different proportions, different, you know.
And there are many other scores he's done that aren't remotely like those. It's just that those ones happen to have very similar themes to them.
Yeah, they all
have iconic, aren't they?
Yeah, and someone that knows more about the construction of music could probably speak better on it, but I'm not that person.
Yeah, nor am I. I was amazed, though, when I was looking up that he's been creating music since the 50s, and he has the last movie that he's about to produce now on IMDb so far is Ready Player One, which is coming out in 2019. So that's nearly 7 decades of music.
That's incredible.
That's unbelievable. Like, nobody works that long in any field.
He's 84 and still, working harder than ever.
He must have. What was the very first one he did then?
I have no clue. I mean. So just going to IMDb, 305 credits for soundtrack alone. Yeah.
It's shocking, isn't it?
Isn't that, like, how do you work that much? I don't know. there was a TV series, Peter Gunn, which I'm not familiar with, but then Some Like It Hot, you know, with Marilyn Monroe.
Oh, okay.
Yeah. Yes, that was 1959, so yeah. and it's just crazy with them. Like, you could ask... His movies the movies he's worked on just span, like I said, so much time. So different people are going to have different connections with him. They might be thinking of the Harry Potter soundtrack or the score or Star Wars will always be what they go to. It's just, you're never going to get one solid answer when you think of him, which is just a testament to how long he's worked and how well he's worked.
Yeah.
You're so right with that. You're so right. Because you say John Williams to me, I think Indiana Jones. Mm-hmm. You know, you've nailed it on the head there with that one. Everyone has their own little niche with Williams.
Yeah.
I'd probably say off the top of my head, if anyone wanted a John Williams score for me, it's Jurassic Park, just because there is nothing that creates more nostalgia for me than hearing that song, theme music.
And I will get goosebumps now talking about it. but that, you know, the hopefully everyone has seen Jurassic Park up to this point, but, you know, when the dust has settled and they're flying away in that chopper and the soft version of that, it just gives me chills every time.
Yeah.
And it's probably the main reason most people went to see Jurassic World was because they just used those very few piano notes of the paying homage to the original theme in the trailer.
I was literally about to bring that up is when the in Jurassic World, when the kids got Skim Simpsons or something, is it? He opens up the doors out of the hotel room and it goes out onto the balcony, then over Jurassic Park itself, over Jurassic World. And you hear that music kicks in. It just killed me, basically. I was just in my seat. My mouth was open. popcorn dropped in everywhere, you know. I was like, oh, my God, I'm back to childhood again. This movie has me wrapped around its finger already.
Yeah. I don't think there are too many films that can do that. But most John Williams films can.
It's just amazing. Yeah, E.T., Jaws. like I said, Superman, of course.
Close Encounters of the Third Kind. The whole movie is based around that team.
Yeah, those, four notes? And you think so simple, but no, he made that.
He has symbiotic relationship with Spielberg that they just get each other. It's like you said earlier on, I think Hans Zimmer has that with Christopher Nolan. They work so well. They're just like their bread and butter, you know, the kind of way you can't beat them.
You're exactly right. Yeah.
Well, and if we're talking about pairings as well, obviously you've also got Tim Burton and Danny Elfman.
Yeah, that's an important one to bring up. I didn't write down any Danny Elfman, which is actually perplexing to me. But
it's things like the Nightmare Before Christmas.
Mm-hmm.
Every single Jack Skellington line is Danny Elfman singing, and he did the music for it. So he's both a singer and composer in a lot of the stuff. So it's something that you don't see a lot of.
Yeah, he's great. He's done like the Men in Black as well, Spider-Man with Sam Raimi, Mission Impossible. You know, he's amazing. Yeah. He also has a new relationship though as well with David O. Russell.
American Hustle.
Yeah.
Yep. Mm-hmm. Yeah, but yeah, for me, it would be Edward Scissorhands for him. The main kind of love theme between Edward and blanking on her name right now, but Winona Ryder.
It's just heartbreaking.
Oh my gosh, yeah, the whole, you know, hold me, I can't, and then that thing, yeah, ugh. Grab the Kleenex. So maybe moving on to, do you have any lesser knowns or kind of...
lesser knowns. Okay, so on my list here, I have Clint Mansell. He's done The Wrestler, Black Swan, Moon.
Fantastic.
Futurama Moon. As well.
Yeah. Yes. Always important to mention that.
Yeah.
Mansell, yeah, I'm not really familiar with that name, unfortunately. That's much to my chagrin here.
Although this is where we start getting into, I will not recognize a single name you mention.
Really?
Don't you worry. When you check out a Spotify playlist, you'll be a fan of his from then on.
Oh, I'm sure.
Yeah. Oh, yeah. Oh, my gosh. Requiem. Yeah. Requiem. There you go. Yep. All right. I'm sold on him. If that was him in Requiem, yeah, that's awesome. So, yep. You got me. I need to give a nod to Howard Shore for the Lord of the Rings trilogy.
Wow.
Even though that relationship kind of fizzled or whatever with him and Peter Jackson. Those three films, I think, are beautifully scored.
They are epic, aren't they? Just in nature. They're so commanding.
I mean, this was back when I still bought CDs, but I bought all those, and I would just play them, you know, on repeat. It just takes you through the entire film. It was like another way to enjoy the film after I'd already seen it, you know, in the theaters. And yeah, I really have a strong connection with that score. It is epic. you get that sense, you know, as you listen.
You do. And I find it interesting that, like, for me, when it comes to thinking about film music, I think about it more the way that Quentin Tarantino does, where he makes himself a playlist of songs that he wants in the film and then kind of builds it around that. And then you get... when you're actually looking down the films, it's not that at all. It's all of these great composers who are able to watch these films and then compose these fantastic music around it. Like my favorite that I didn't really know, but upon researching a little bit, now I do realize, is actually Thomas Newman, because he did the score for Shawshank Redemption.
Mm-hmm.
And that track, it's called Shawshank Redemption. When... spoilers for Shawshank Redemption, when Andy gets
out.
I
think we're good there.
And he's out in the rain.
Spoiler, he dies.
I know. And then just that music swell as he's breaking out, and then when he is out and the camera just zooms out. Like, it's such a perfect marriage of that music and those visuals.
Yeah. Also, yeah. Wally. Can I throw Wally too. Out there? Yeah, for Thomas Newman. Sorry, so, I interrupted you once again, Stephen.
No, ahead. It's okay. I don't know about you guys. If he's like, I'm willing to admit that I'm one of those guys who has that single tear moment when I watch movies at certain times. But I find that it's never the story as such. It's always the music that accompanies the scene or the story or the emotions that gets me. You know, if you take away the music, there's absolutely nothing there. And well, it's minimal, but when you have that music and certain chords and just hit you and kind of get that little lip quiver, you know, did you ever watch The Impossible, the one about the tsunami?
Yes.
With Ewan McGregor? That had me like,
oh my God.
I had everybody in the cinema crying, I think. And it wouldn't have been as impactful if it wasn't for the score that's accompanying it as well.
Yeah. Let me say, I'm very happy that was one of the films I went to see by myself. I was a mess through that film. I couldn't see parts of it because it was too cloudy. The vision was too cloudy.
I have not seen it myself. As Brian will probably attest to, I would probably not quite have the same reaction, but I am a cold-hearted bastard.
You are a cold-hearted bastard, but that one might be the test for you. I don't know. It's such a beautiful, small film, and yeah, that score is... It'll tug at you.
All right.
With the tension and drama of the happenings, the goings on, yeah.
Alright, I'll give it a go.
Challenge. I've never been so emotionally invested in a movie in my life as it was that one. And I didn't even know what it was about really going into it. Mm-hmm. But I left just screaming its praises, you know, telling everybody about it. They have to go see it.
Yeah,
but yeah, it should be on your list.
Yeah, that's a really nice mention. Yeah. I did want to bring up James Horner, who we lost last year, sadly. If you're not familiar, if people aren't familiar with his work, Titanic, Avatar, Braveheart, Field of Dreams.
A James Cameron relationship with him, isn't it, really?
Yeah. He was 60, only 61. He's just another one of those that will just transport you back to when you experienced that film. Avatar has, we can go on about Avatar, but that score is definitely spot on for that film. And, of course, Braveheart, which, I think Paul, not the biggest fan of, is that correct?
I have not seen much of it. I can tell you my university...
For how historically accurate it is?
Yeah, rips it apart every time you bring it up.
But it is a touching and compelling score in that film. I don't know. He's one of my all-time favorites. And sad that we don't get to hear any more music from him. But he left us with a lot, so... Yeah, I just wanted to... All right, now that I brought everyone down.
Aliens gets... I love Aliens with it. It's that militaristic kind of the beating of the drums and everything. It's fantastic.
Yeah, I haven't really thought about the Alien film, but yeah, that's good. There's a lot of horror films that would genuinely be nothing without the soundtracks. And
they all don't have to be just boo.
As they are now.
Like The Omen or blanking on a couple, but yeah, they are.
The Omen, fantastic. Pretty much any Hitchcock film.
Yeah,
just when those violins start up.
It's crazy how you can just hear a piece of music and you know that that's from a Hitchcock. You hear the same instruments being used, and it's like all
vertigo,
kind of lilting, and it's full of anxiety, and
you got Vertigo, North by Northwest. North by Northwest, actually, Brian was playing it for me earlier. If you listen to just the first few seconds of the score from that, it does kind of sound a little bit like the Psycho one.
Really? I have to check that out.
I think Psycho... My favorite thing about Psycho is that Alfred Hitchcock, when he was making it, and I don't know if that includes by the time he was scoring it, but when he was making it, he was absolutely convinced he was making a comedy.
Twisted.
I know. He thought that he was making a comedy because he was making fun of horror films with what he was doing. And he made fun of it so well, he made a horror thriller.
Well, there you go. Change the score and you have a comedy.
Exactly.
Little, 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 little.
Oh, my God.
Just have the shower curtain get pulled back and you just hear wah, wah.
Wah.
Yeah.
Halloween, though. So good at just making you essentially shit yourself. I'll just say, it sticks with you, it haunts you.
The Exorcist, I don't think that particular piece of music was written for the film, but just the use of that song the Tubular Bells was
inspired. Thank you. Gosh, I could not. Yeah. I've been trying to think of that. Tubular, please put Tubular Bells on there because, on that playlist. Thank God. For once, thank you. Because that was gnawing at my brain. I could not think of the name of that.
I actually knew something musicals that you didn't.
I knew it. I just didn't know it when it counted, okay? When it mattered the most. So don't fault me there.
You're so right about The Exorcist, The Omen, all those, the Psycho. Once you hear those themes, you automatically get transported into those movies. There's no person in the world, even if you haven't seen those movies, you know that they exist for those movies.
And I was going to bring up Disney because of the original Disney cartoon relied so heavily on the music, but that reminded me as well. If you have the time, like it's only a couple of minutes, look up someone made the Mary Poppins trailer for Mary Poppins as if it was a horror film. Oh, and really? All they did was would put specific music on.
Are you saying it is not a horror film?
No, it's a horror ball film.
I was quite horrified by it.
it's a horror ball film, but it's not at present a horror film.
All right. Isn't at one point she comes down the chimney or something or goes up a chimney? Yeah, that does sound pretty horrific.
Scary lady.
Well, that is one moment in the thing. I think they slightly slow it down when the children go up the chimney, and they just add this extra little sting to it, and it's just like,
oh, I really want to see that now.
Straight out of our, it's brilliant.
I think we might be, what are we doing on time? Okay, we've got to wrap things up in a little bit here on this one. But I did have a couple of honorable mentions here. Alan Silvestri for the Back to the Future score.
Yeah.
I mean, that's a film that relies mostly on soundtrack, but that main theme is just, I was just listening to, I have the album, and I was just listening to that before we started recording. Yeah,
the main theme, it's just called Back to the Future Overture.
And it immediately, like, it does such a great job of just taking you back, and you can see the action in your head as you listen to that music. You know Doc Brown struggling, trying to get the plug plugged in, and, you know,
You know, Marty's just arrived back in 1950 Silver Valley.
Yeah, it's all there. It all just paints the picture so well. So yeah, I had to bring him up.
It is 2016 after all.
Harold Faltermeyer for the Beverly Hills Cop theme. Are you familiar with that one?
Wow. I would never have thought about that.
So iconic of the 80s, just synthesized out to the extreme, you know. But I just love that. It'll hole in your brain and it'll never leave. So I guess that's a sign of a good score. So I would bring him up. This one, Paul, I think you will be on board with me. Raymond Djawadi for Pacific Rim. I don't know your feelings on that film. Paul and I are big lovers of that movie, and the score is as over the top as the film is.
Yeah, it's an amazing like 3-star movie in the sense that, like, you know, it is what it is, but it just does it so well. You know, it's just like it's perfect for what it is.
Yeah, I try to explain when people say like, "Oh, I've not seen it." I'm like, okay. Like basically, if you're a guy and you sit down and watch this film, you are immediately 8 years old again. When it starts up, and
giant robots fighting giant monsters. I mean, that is that's all you need. to know.
It's everything you want Transformers and Power Rangers to be.
That's, I mean, a testament to Guillermo, of course, that he's the guy that can make that movie, and that's why it played so well. He knew the genres he was bringing together.
Yeah, and that theme track, like I had that on repeat for a while.
Yeah, it's just so guitar heavy and powerful and driven, and just gets you pumped up as you should be getting pumped up for these big epic battles.
Do not be shaving when you're listening to it.
I think, was that a post of mine?
I think it was.
Yeah, I was obsessed.
That's a t-shirt
with that
right there.
Yeah, I was obsessed with that score for a very long time after that film, and I would just, oh my God, you play that in the morning and you feel so good about your day. But yes, I was shaving at one point, and that was just not a good idea. I think I shaved my face in about 4 seconds.
One trip to the emergency room later.
Yeah, just a few bits of toilet paper hanging around my face. But for other activities, please, it will motivate you.
Yeah, especially coming home from work, I think is the best time to play this stuff. You know, when you're walking, if you have to walk to a bus or a tube or whatever it is, you put these on and it gives you that extra pep in your step.
All right. This is a bit of a reach here, but there was an episode of Family Guy where Peter gets a soundtrack for his life.
Oh yeah.
Do you recall that? Okay, anyone? But I also, when I worked back in my days working at the movie theater I worked at, I always told them, like, I would love the Indiana Jones theme to just play anytime I entered a room, and then anytime I exited, just dun, 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 and then you just have to kind of saunter in and hello, hello, how are you? Hi. And then leaving. Bye, everyone. Bye.
You do
that would
realize
make
that
my
was,
life immeasurably better.
if your life was if that was a plot of a movie, you do realize that like halfway through a boulder would come and attack you, and that's when you realize the Nazis are after you then as well, you know?
I guess, yeah, I guess I gotta take the bad with the good, huh?
That could actually be an interesting film idea. Maybe like someone starts listening to film soundtracks and things around them start changing to mirror the films.
Here we go. I
to
see
go
you a
story
Storybreakers episode.
Awesome. Love it.
All right. I
have,
don't know that.
I have two guys that I have to throw in here
Oh,
before we go.
absolutely, please.
Trent Reznor, he does
Oh, yeah.
Social Network, Gone Girl, Girl with the Dragon Tattoo. He does like this kind of real punk. It's amazing. His scores are so unique, and
Yeah, to
also
come
like
from Nine Inch
repeat.
Nails and then, yeah,
yes, that's
the unique
right.
scores. Oh, my God. Yeah.
And
Yeah, that's a
Michael
good one. Thank
Giacchino
you for
just
bringing
for
him
Star Trek,
up. Yeah,
the latest Star Trek movies, and I think those movies wouldn't be the same thing without that opening theme tune.
enough. Definitely not, no.
Oh.
And the only other thing I would throw out there is also going to be very random, come for me since I don't really listen to him, but Daft Punk.
Oh yeah,
Because obviously they had
Tron. That
Tron
Tron,
Legacy
Tron
and
2 is amazing.
yeah, I mean the film itself was like, all right and nice to look at, but yeah, that soundtrack, that's all them. Like that's and not many people could do every single piece of music in a film. So it's
Yeah,
really cool that they
definitely.
got
Yeah.
free rein over
We're partial sight as well, because I don't know how they can see keys in those masks, those helmets. It's
True.
just talent.
Yeah.
And I think you had one more there, Stephen?
Oh no,
No,
no, I'm
they
sorry.
were two. They were two.
Oh, okay. And I just thought of just one more, the Duffer Brothers for Fight Club. I
Oh,
believe
there
that
you
was their
go.
first score that they had worked on. And that is just, I can't imagine that film sounding any other way. It's so chaotic and representative of that story. Yeah, like I said, I can't imagine that music sounding any differently.
Yeah.
It's perfect for it. Yeah. And then Ennio Morricone, of course, that I could not think of who Quentin worked with all the time, but yeah, that I just need to give him a shout out for Hateful Eight and the other films he's worked on with Quentin. But
Yeah.
yeah, that's all I had.
Well, what
Yeah, people are probably going to hate us because we're out there leaving off their favorites, you
I
know.
know. I mean,
But
we can't get them all.
yeah, that's it.
Yeah, it's just.
Well, you know that someone loves the score from Plan 9 from Outer Space, and they're like, "How did you not mention that one?"
Killer
I
Clowns would not
love
be the same
Theremin.
without
It's
us.
from like the Theremin just group or something. Yeah, just yeah. I don't know. Yep.
Well,
Yeah, so sorry if we left off your favorites, Paul. I'm sorry. Did you have any last ones to throw in before we wrap it up?
no, I was just going to say, like, obviously you're putting together the Spotify playlist. Like, why don't we see if we can, having now talked about it, which ones would we throw in? Like, what, Brian, what would you put in? Like, if you had to pick a score, like, a theme, like, whatever.
Well, definitely the main theme from Jurassic Park.
Okay. Yes.
Beverly Hills Cop. It's got to be on there. Back to the Future. Yeah, pretty much. Yeah, just listen to this episode again. That would be my playlist.
I have a list here of 14 top quality tunes we're out to pick, and they'll all go onto that Spotify playlist.
Yeah,
well, so everyone can check them out. I think it'll probably be longer than the episode itself.
Yeah. Definitely make sure that Shawshank Redemption is on that, and that is the name of the track as well, not just the drum. But yeah, that I would not like it if you left that one off.
I would not care for it one bit.
No, I would not. All right.
All right, I think that might wrap up this episode of Film for Thought. Sorry if we left off your favorites, but do let us know at Blokebusters. Stephen, what's your handle?
You can hit us up at thestorybreakers.com or on Twitter, it's Storybreakers, Facebook, Storybreakers. It's all Storybreakers everywhere.
Okay, yeah, we're both so everywhere. So yeah.
No excuse not to find us.
All right.
I've been Paul.
I've been Brian.
I've been Stephen. Thank you very much for having me, guys.
No problem.
Of course. Bye, folks.
Bye.